Penguin Random House Audio presents Becoming Steve Jobs, The Evolution of a Reckless Upstart into a Visionary Leader by Brent Schlender and Rick Tetzeli. Read for you by George Newbern. Author's Note: The reporting and writing of this book is the work of two authors. The two of us have worked together for years, going back to our time together at Fortune magazine. For Becoming Steve Jobs, we spent 3 years researching, interviewing, reporting, writing, and editing together. That said, in the narrative you're about to read, we decided, for convenience's sake, to use the first person singular throughout to refer to Brent. Brent is the one who had a relationship of almost a quarter century with Steve Jobs. So using the word I made it much easier to tell our story. Prologue. You're new here, aren't you? Those were his first words to me. His last, 25 years later, would be, I'm sorry. Already he had turned the tables on me. After all, I was the reporter, the one who was supposed to be asking the questions. I had been warned about the unique challenges of interviewing Steve Jobs. The night before, over beers, my new colleagues at the San Francisco Bureau of the Wall Street Journal had told me to bring a flak jacket to this first meeting. One of them said, only half-jokingly, that interviewing Jobs was often more combat than questioning. It was April 1986, and Jobs was already a journal legend. Bureau lore had it that he had dressed down another journal reporter by posing this straightforward question: Do you understand anything at all? Anything at all about what we're discussing? I'd had plenty of experience with real flak jackets during my years reporting in Central America in the early 1980s. I'd spent much of that time in El Salvador and Nicaragua, where I'd interviewed everyone from truck drivers motoring through war zones to American military advisors in the jungle, to contra comandantes in their hideouts, to presidents in their palaces. On other assignments, I'd met with obstreperous billionaires like T. Boone Pickens and H. Ross Perot and Lee Ka-shing, with Nobel Prize winners like Jack Kilby, with rock stars and movie idols, renegade polygamists, and even the grandmothers of would-be assassins. I wasn't easily intimidated. Yet, for the full 20-minute drive from my home in San Mateo, California, to the headquarters of Next Computer in Palo Alto, I brooded and fretted about how best to interview Jobs. Part of my unease came from the fact that, for the first time in my experience as a journalist, I would be calling on a prominent business leader who was younger than I. I was 32 years old. Jobs was 31 and already a global celebrity, hailed, along with Bill Gates, for having invented the personal computer industry. Long before internet mania started churning out wunderkinds of the week, Jobs was technology's original superstar, the real deal with an astounding, substantial record. The circuit boards he and Steve Wozniak had assembled in a garage in Los Altos had spawned a billion-dollar company. The personal computer seemed to have unlimited potential, and as the co-founder of Apple Computer, Steve Jobs had been the face of all those possibilities. But then, in September of 1985, he had resigned under pressure, shortly after telling the company's board of directors that he was courting some key Apple employees to join him in a new venture to build computer workstations. The fascinated media had thoroughly dissected his departure, with both Fortune and Newsweek putting the ignominious saga on their covers. In the 6 months since, the details of his new startup had been kept hush-hush, in part because Apple had filed lawsuits trying to prevent Jobs from hiring away its employees. But Apple had finally dropped those suits. And now, according to the publicist from Jobs' PR agency, who called my boss at the Journal, Steve was willing to do a handful of interviews with major business publications. He was ready to start the public fan dance that would begin to reveal in detail what exactly Next was up to. I was thoroughly fascinated and equally wary. I didn't want to get taken in by the notoriously charismatic Mr. Jobs. The drive south to Palo Alto is a trip through the history of Silicon Valley. From Route 92 in San Mateo over to Interstate 280, a bucolic eight-laner skirting San Andreas Lake and Crystal Springs Reservoir, which store drinking water for San Francisco, piped in from the Sierras. Past the blandly ostentatious venture capitalist habitat along Sand Hill Road in Menlo Park, and traversing the oblique, mile-long Stanford Linear Accelerator, which slashes like a hairline fracture through the landscape and beneath the freeway. Past the Stanford Dish Radio Telescope and the white-faced Herefords and ornate oak trees dotting the expansive greenbelt behind the university campus. The winter and spring rains had resurrected the prairie grass on the hills, turning them briefly as green as a golf course from their usual dull yellow, and peppering them with patches of orange, purple, and yellow wildflowers. I was so new to the Bay Area that I didn't yet realize that this was the most beautiful time of year to make this drive. My exit, Page Mill Road, was the home street address of Hewlett-Packard, early biotech pioneer Alza Corporation, Silicon Valley facilitators like Anderson Consulting, now called Accenture, and the law firm Wilson, Sonsini, Goodrich, and Rosati. But first you hit the university-owned Stanford Research Park, with its groves of low-slung corporate research and development labs, situated with lots of grassy elbow room. Xerox's famed Palo Alto Research Center Park, where Steve first saw a computer with a mouse and a graphical bitmapped screen interface, resides here. This was where he had chosen to headquarter next. A young woman from Next's PR firm, Allison Thomas Associates, escorted me through the boxy two-story concrete and glass office building to a small conference room with a view of a half-filled parking lot and not much more. Steve was waiting there. He greeted me with a nod, dismissed the flack, and before I could get seated, popped that first question. I wasn't sure if Steve wanted a monosyllabic answer or if he was genuinely curious about who I was and where I came from. I assumed the latter, so I started ticking off the places and industries I'd written about for the journal. Right after leaving graduate school at the University of Kansas, I'd moved to Dallas for the paper, where I'd written about aviation, airlines, and electronics, since Texas Instruments and Radio Shack were based there. Along the way, I had won some notoriety for a profile of John Hinckley, the privileged son of a Texas oil man who shot President Reagan in 1981. "What year did you graduate from high school?" he interjected. 1972, I replied. "And I spent 7 years in college, but never quite got my master's degree." "That's when I graduated from high school," he interjected. "So we're about the same age." I found out later that he had skipped a grade. I then explained that I'd spent 2 years each in Central America and Hong Kong writing and reporting on geopolitical issues for the journal, and a year in Los Angeles before finally wangling my dream job in San Francisco. At this point, it really was beginning to feel like a job interview, except that Jobs wasn't reacting much to any of my answers. "So, do you know anything about computers?" he asked, interrupting again. "Nobody who writes for the major national publications knows shit about computers," he added, shaking his head with a practiced air of condescension. "The last person who wrote about me for the Wall Street Journal didn't even know the difference between machine memory and a floppy." Now I felt on somewhat firmer footing. Well, I was an English major, formally, but I programmed some simple games and designed relational databases on a mainframe in college. He rolled his eyes. "For a couple of years, I worked nights as a computer operator processing the daily transactions for four banks on an NCR minicomputer." He was staring out the window now. "And I bought an IBM PC the very first day they were available, at Businessland, in Dallas. Its serial number started out with 80s, and I installed CPM first. I only installed MS-DOS when I sold it before we moved to Hong Kong, because that's what the buyer wanted." At the mention of those early operating systems and a competitor's product, he perked up. "Why didn't you get an Apple II?" he asked. Good question. But seriously, why was I letting this guy interview me? "I never had one," I allowed. "But now that I'm here, I got the journal to buy me a Fat Mac." I had convinced the big guys in New York that if I was going to be writing about Apple, I'd better be familiar with their latest machines. "I've been using it for a couple of weeks. So far, I do like it better than a PC." I had picked the lock. "Wait till you see what we're going to build here," he told me. "You'll want to get rid of your Fat Mac." We'd finally reached the point of the interview, the destination Steve had wanted all along, the place where he could tell me how he was going to outdo the company he had founded, and best the people, most notably Apple CEO John Sculley, who had effectively banished him from that kingdom. Now he would take my question.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.